Hi everyone, it's Laurie. It's been a little while since I did a video, and so I thought maybe the best way to get back on the horse?
Wagon?
Get back on the wagon.
Would horse be, wagon.
Horse and wagon.
Horse wagon.
Would be to do a video response, and the lovely Lisa of Tarot Alchemist gave us a really fantastic one just yesterday, I think. Mm-hmm. It's not originally from Lisa, it's originally from, let's see, Arwen Lynch. And, this is a video response to Lisa's video response. The hashtag is tarot tag 15, and it is 15 questions for everyone to answer. And so I thought it would be especially fun to bring, once again in my lovely co-star Gracie, who was a gigantic hit last time, and Yay. So we're bringing her back for more episodes. So we did not talk about how we want to do this. Do you want to do, like, you start on odd and I start on even, or vice versa? Okay. Sounds great. You're going to start on evens, so mm-hmm. That means I go first.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So the very first question is, what is your current favorite deck? My current favorite deck for about a month, I think, has been the Aquarian Tarot in the Tin. So this is my current favorite deck. Everyone's seen it.
It's cute. I like it.
Everyone has seen the little itty bitty bitty Aquarian Tarot.
Show the backs because those are pretty too.
So, we're super far away from the camera.
It's okay, you can just zoom in when we have it.
Yeah, because
reasons.
It's an old camera, and we can't fit both of us in. Okay.
Okay.
So what is your current favorite tarot?
My current favorite deck is The Wild Unknown by Kim Kranz. When I first got this, I actually wasn't a huge fan of it. I'm not sure why. I do like it. It just didn't click with me until we chopped, edged, and edged the cards. So these used to have a big border around them, mm-hmm. and they were cut and edged, and we even colored a few of them. And I should have pulled out some of the, oh, there's one that we
did. You did. We colored a ton of them in together, she and I.
Mm-hmm. I'll pull up these two because they're the first ones that came up.
Because
I love
she likes them to be more colorful.
So there's Mother of Swords and Strength. We colored those two in with just colored pencils. And since we did that, I just really have loved this deck. It really speaks to me right now. I think it's coming out of winter into spring, although I've been transitioning out of this one into using some of my other decks more frequently.
Have you? Because you've been using that deck for quite a while.
Yes.
Like 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I like it because very, like, to me, this one is super straightforward and it doesn't pack any. Oh, it does pack punches. It doesn't pull its punches.
It doesn't pull its punches.
It's really direct. It's fine.
It's been too long since we did a video. All right, question number two. What tarot card do you think stands for who you are
right now?
Okay.
Oh, I have to start. Okay. Pull post-it notes.
So what deck did you use?
I'm using the Bonefire Tarot. I don't know who it's by. I don't have the box with me.
It's by Gabby.
So I'm using the lovely Bonefire Tarot, mm-hmm. and
this is the new mass market
version, which I edged. It used to be white, mm-hmm. and I'm sorry I'm taking so long.
You're not taking long. It's fine.
I edged it black because it just like works, really.
Yeah.
I didn't want to edge it at first because I was a bit worried I wasn't gonna like it, but then as soon as I started edging it, it completed the deck.
Yeah, it's like phenomenal. Look how gorgeous that is.
It just works for me.
Oh
so
my gosh.
I couldn't be happier with it.
I love it. It's huge.
It is. Okay. So the card that I feel represents me right now, and I was kind of a little bit just going off the picture on the card and not entirely from the traditional Smith-Waite meanings.
Yeah, that's fine. Intuitively, that's great.
And it's the Page of Wands. I love her sitting up in her apple tree, throwing flaming paper planes at people. I don't know if that's exactly who I am right now, but it does kind of feel like that some days. So, I don't know. I just like her. So that's the energy at least I feel like right now.
Yeah.
Even if I'm not necessarily throwing flaming paper planes at people.
And do you want to do the second one too of who do you think stands for who you want to be? Because yes, we sure can kind of contrast those.
I put post-it notes on everything because I did that last night. So then the one I picked for who do I want to be is the Eight of Coins. The master craftswoman in this one. She's fun. She's painting, and I love that. She looks so creative, and like she's really having a good time and doing what she loves. So I would love to be able to do that sometime. Like, that's who I want to be. So.
Well, these were fantastic. Those were really good. I actually drew a card for you, because I'm a mom.
I drew one for you, too.
Did you? Of what tarot card do I think stands for who you are now? Because sometimes I think we don't see each other. We don't see ourselves the way other people see us.
Should we give each other the ones and then?
Yeah. Okay.
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 So that's the card I drew for you from the Mythical Goddess Tarot.
Okay.
And this is the one you drew for me from the Bonfire Tarot.
That's okay. Stephanie. Aww.
Aww.
Three of Earth works. It's called. This is the Three of Pentacles.
Yeah. And the reason I picked this girl for you is because you're in something of a transition time right now, you know, as you're moving from high school and then you're going to be going to college next mm-hmm. year. And so you're really active, and this girl is like she's super active, and she's young and she's active, but you can see that she's really connected. And she's a three, so she's got her whole life ahead of her. You know, you got your whole life ahead of you,
mm-hmm.
but she's completely connected to ground, to earth. She's grounded, but she's very active. She's connected up here to spirit. All her kind of chakras are in alignment. She's just got everything lined up, and I think that's kind of where you are right now. You've got all your ducks in a row, and you're ready to go out into the world, but you're really grounded in who you are, and I think that's a really neat place to be.
Yay.
And you picked for me
the Six of Cups.
The Six of Cups.
Because of course you're my mom, so I associate with you with nostalgia and things like that, but I think that's kind of always the person you've been. It's just someone who creates that little bubble, that like perfect little bubble everywhere you go.
Of
happiness.
Love.
And
what? Emotion?
The lotus is in there.
Aww.
You love lotuses so much.
I do love lotuses.
So I feel like mine was picked more because of the picture than like the meaning behind it, but I don't know, maybe that works too.
Well, I kind of like this, and if you notice the symbol on the child,
mm-hmm.
there's the downward pointing
triangle
on the child, which is the water symbol, even though it's in red, it's the water. So it's sort of like emotional, and it's down at her, where her root chakra would be, down at the base of her spine. So I know that's not technically where it is, but so it's kind of the mama is giving the little girl roots, you know?
Oh, I love that.
This is sweet. Thank you. That was really sweet. Okay, so I'm going to do, what tarot card do you think stands for who I am right now, and what tarot card stands for who I want to be? And I chose the Osho Zen Tarot, which I'm using a lot right now as well.
I love that one. So
and great. This right now, this is a bit what it feels like right now. What is it?
This moment is, to moment.
Moment to moment. It's supposed to be the Two of Rainbows, which is the Two of Pentacles, and I'm kind of, hopping from rock to rock in that very, very busy stream, and that's kind of what it feels like at the moment, trying to balance everything. Things are a bit crazy, and it's been crazy for a while, and I think it's kind of probably time I need to deliberately slow that down and not wait for it to happen naturally. And who do I want to be? And I picked, I'm trying to remember what this card is. This is, I'm fairly sure this is the Page of Cups. But I want to be trust. And I just love this image.
Okay.
And I see this image as a little child who has been picked up by his or her, parent or dad or an uncle or a granddad or somebody really safe and trustworthy, and just thrown up into the air the way people do with little kids. And she's just in the air, happy as anything, because she knows someone's gonna catch her. Question 4, it's yours.
Oh, okay. Draw a tarot card and tell us how it answers the question, what's the universe want you to know right now?
Oh, what's the universe want me to know right now?
Yes.
Awesome. And am I going to draw for what the universe wants you to know right now?
Yes.
Awesome.
Okay.
Okay.
So I'm using the Idiosyncratic Tarot by Jessica Bott. We actually did a video unboxing of this when I got this, and the Cracked Amethyst Oracle, which is also by Jessica Bott. Unfortunately, you cannot get this tarot deck anymore. It's a really beautiful deck. Go watch our unboxing of it.
There are a ton of unboxings now.
Yes.
Ooh.
Yeah. You should watch ours.
I've seen them. Yes. Of course. You should watch ours.
You should watch ours. So it's a really lovely deck. I really like it. Very. Okay. I guess we'll go with that.
This is what the universe wants me to know right now.
Okay.
I'm ready.
So the card is the Nine of Arrows, and Arrows is wands in traditional Waitsmith artwork, and I'm blanking on the meaning.
Well, one of my favorite ones is from, one of my favorite Nine of Wands is from the Tarot of the She, and because he's the guardian. So, I don't know, maybe that's the universe saying, hey, you are going to be caught if you jump. You know, there's a guardian.
So it's a jumping card. I just started shuffling it.
And that was a jumping card. So, okay. I'll journal about that and meditate on that. All right. So is it all right if I use the Aquarian tarot for you?
I received that.
I have a fantastic tarot Reiki client who, when anyone says something to her that kind of you would normally say, oh, thank you, but that's not really me, or oh, I did that by accident, or like a compliment or something positive. And I think a lot of times we tend to be like, we think it's important to be humble, and so we'll sort of respond kind of in a
self-deprecating or dismissive way.
Yeah, a dismissive way of ourselves, and the languaging is really super important. And instead of saying, oh, no, it was nothing or something like that, she says, I received that. I received that. And so I've been using that for years since I met her. Okay, I've got to get my elbow down so I can shuffle properly. let's see if I get a jumper. What does the universe want my beautiful Gracie to know right now? What does the universe want Gracie to know right now? I'm actually quite good at shuffling these cards because they're small. Mm-hmm. I should have picked a big deck because I would drop. Oh, all right. That one seems like it wants to be Queen of Cups.
Oh. She's one of the ones I almost picked for you in my bonfire.
Queen of Cups. You are totally the master of your emotions and your creativity. Yeah. You got it under control right now. Just looking at her.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Right up here at her crown. Her crown chakra. See, it's this purple, it's sort of like her crown chakra, which is on her crown, and it's like open, and it's gorgeous, and it's big, and it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. And so her crown chakra is open and totally connected, just like yours was in that image of the girl, the dancing girl, yeah. And then look what else we've got. We've got her throat chakra, or maybe her heart, because it's green, and that kind of goes with that. And then we've got love. She's holding a rose, so she's, you know, she's loved, and she knows she's loved, and it's right at her solar plexus, which is kind of where that one, which is where, of course, the yellow one was. And so all that kind of goes. That kind of validates the universe. Thinks all the universe loves you just as much as your mama does.
I feel like I should have gone into more detail with yours.
Oh no, that was great. All right,
five.
Go ahead, will you read it?
Okay. What? Oh, sorry. Do you have any cards that you must love in order to work with a tarot deck?
No.
Okay.
No, I don't. But there are a couple of tarot decks that the cards are so not okay for me, really, right now. So.
I think that's fine.
Thank you. What about you?
I don't really have any that I must love every card in order to work with a deck, or there must be, like, I must love the specific card, but I feel like I judge a deck based on certain cards. So, like, I usually tend to look at, if I'm looking at a deck, Death, the Devil, and the Lovers. You have the three problem cards.
Mm-hmm.
Because I feel like if the artist portrayed those cards in a way that I like and isn't salacious, in a way, like, if they don't make the cards too salacious, that doesn't necessarily mean they make them, like, dirty, but I mean, like, if they don't sensualize like the devil and the lovers and those cards. And then I feel like maybe I might connect with the deck more. Mm-hmm. And I feel, because I feel like how you portray those cards is really important to how you're going to portray the rest of the cards.
Hmm.
If that makes any sense?
It does. Excellent.
Awesome. Is the next one mine?
Six. Is this Y Tarot?
Yes. Y Tarot, not as some other divination system.
I don't really feel like I do divination. I mean, I started doing tarot because I was doing, because I've been working for a couple of years with my intuitive teacher, and we do a variety of readings, Akashic record readings and past life readings and guardian angels, spirit guides, different sorts of those things in the middle of this course, and I've been studying with her for several years, and in the middle of this she says, well, if you're having some difficulty with this one particular area, just pull a tarot card or an oracle card. And I was like, I know nothing about tarot cards and oracle cards. This was last year. I mean, I knew nothing at all. So I, to my other course, I'm like, wait here, I'll be right back. And so I started digging into tarot, and then it's been, down the rabbit hole. So that's why I started tarot. The reason I've been continuing is because I just read, I have to look at my notes, I'm sorry. I just read this quote in a book called Karmic Tarot, and it's by William Lamme, L-A-M-M-E-Y or Lamme. And he says, why tarot? And he says, because God doesn't speak English.
I like that.
Yeah, and because spirit doesn't speak to us all the time in English. It speaks in symbols. And even our own minds and our own memories, connecting with my higher self, a lot of that happens best through symbols. I mean, it happens through intuition. It happens through a lot of different ways that I use. And but I found that tarot kind of transcends the limitations of different kinds of intuition. So we can have these really beautiful pieces of art that we can tangibly hold and connect then to our higher selves or to source or to do that for other people in a way that they can look at and immediately understand, or we can tell the story in the cards if it's not a card that they're looking at, and they can click and it connects on you know, that archetypal level. And then all of that feeds back into the intuitive stuff that I do, and Reiki and a bunch of other things. So how about you? Why do you like tarot?
I don't
it was accidental.
Yeah, you started doing tarot, and with everything else, I was like, oh, this looks like fun. Mm-hmm. I'll buy a deck.
Yeah.
And that was last summer?
Yeah, I think it was last year.
So that was, just kind of fell into it too.
Why do you still like it?
I think it's a nice handy tool, and like, I feel like rune casting, which I've tried, palmistry, I'm not sure how that's, like, what's that, if that's considered real divination or not, and I'm not gonna say anything about that either way. Tea leaf reading, things like that, it always felt very inaccessible, whereas tarot reading, as soon as I got a book, which I'll be showing in a minute for the next question, it just felt accessible and something I could do. And then as soon as I started learning it, once I started learning, there was no going back. So, and now I use it daily, so.
You do. You really do. You know, I really wish in a way I had this when you guys were little, because I think it's such a concrete way for children to understand things that are a little bit more obscure, or even for children that are pre-verbal to kind of connect and talk about very deep things when we don't have quite the language for it. We adults don't have the language for spirit. Anyway, that's a completely different subject. Okay, next question.
What's the first book you can remember reading about tarot, other than the standard little white book?
And it's an odd number, is that mean it's mine?
Yes.
Okay. So the first book, I just actually know. The first book that I ever read that had anything to do with the tarot, I read quite a long time ago, and it's called Meditations on the Tarot. And I read it just because actually I have long been interested in kind of esoteric Christianity. And this was a book that it falls into that. I think it's Christian mysticism. No, it's Christian hermeticism. And it kind of falls into that. And so that's probably the first book I read on tarot. And it didn't even connect that it was tarot cards. I was reading it more sort of as religious, symbolic, kind of mysticism. I don't know. Anyway, so that would be the first one I read, but it was a long time ago. The first one I read when I was trying to look at tarot is just one I got off of Amazon, and it's the True Tarot Card Meanings, Learn the Secrets of Tarot Professionals by Andrea Green. And I didn't understand any of it. It just completely went over my head, but I was flipping through it again in preparation for this, and it's not bad. It's got like some tips and stuff. I think I needed to be in a different place in order to be able to understand what she was saying, so. What about you, darling?
Okay. Pull up all my post-it notes. The first book on tarot that I read, this is actually like the legit first book, because even when I got my tarot deck, I didn't read the little white book, because it was intimidatingly big. It was for the Line Strider Tarot. And so, you know, it's like practically a novel.
Is it?
It is. It's upstairs on my bookshelf. I haven't looked at it since I got the deck.
I didn't
probably
know that.
Should do that.
You can do what you want.
But the first one I got was one that you had on your bookshelf that I picked up because it looked like
Never read that.
A Magical Course in Tarot by Michelle Morgan. It was really good. I like the way she came at it because when I first started, she sort of came at it how she had fallen into tarot, which was, I think, she happened to be at a metaphysical shop when they were holding a tarot class, and you could just join it.
Nice.
So she did.
Mm-hmm.
And then she kind of went through it, and it started really becoming a part of her life, and then she goes through and explains all the cards, using mostly traditional Waite-Smith meanings, some spreads. She goes into a lot of really great detail, how to read them, etc. So it was a really good first book. I still refer back to it every so often, but I'm not 100% sure about stuff.
I'll have to look at that.
Yeah. It was good. It was nice. I liked that it was modern.
Mm-hmm.
It had a more modern feel and like making sort of the tarot accessible to the youth.
The youths.
The youth.
Young peoples.
Young peeps.
Okay. 8. What tarot person would you like to chat with?
Do I go first or do you go first?
It's an even number, so I think it's yours.
Yes. Okay. Well, the first one I like to chat with, I think everyone should probably recognize this photo. It's Pixie Smith, Pamela Coleman Smith of Rider-Waite-Smith.
Smith-Waite.
I prefer Smith-Waite.
Yeah, we started doing that.
Since Smith and Waite were the people who actually did all the work.
Oh.
Something I found interesting about her from the Vampire Tarot little white book was that she knew the author of the book Dracula, Bram Stoker. She was in his sort of bohemian artistic circle, which would have been awesome. I would love to just sit down and talk with her. She looks like such an awesome, fun person. I just love that is her picture. She looks like such a open and like lovely person. I love to sit down with her, talk with her, and I also think if you know her,
that's me.
That's you. What about you?
Oh, okay. Here's a clue of what tarot person I would most like to talk to. It's a knitting book. And another one. And another one. Okay, can you see who it's by? Barbara Walker. Is there a picture of her in here? I can't remember. I first encountered Barbara Walker because I've been a knitter for like 30 years. And you can see we have her very well-loved books.
That's a nice pattern.
Yeah. Gracie's a knitter as well. And so she would be, I don't have her deck. Her deck was just released in a tin form.
We need to get that like now.
And it's like cheap. I don't even have it. I don't own it.
We need that.
But I'd love to sit and talk with her. Because we would knit and we could talk feminism and talk with her about, like, you know, the early days of feminism and tarot and all of her crazy research and knitting, and then we could knit.
That sounds great. That sounds like a lot of fun.
It sounds great. Perfect. All my worlds collide. I love it.
Okay.
9. What YouTube channel do you watch and why? And you're only supposed to pick one.
And you're supposed to start?
No.
It's an odd number.
Oh, it's an odd number.
I mean, I can start if you want to have something written down.
Yeah, why don't you start?
Okay. Well, I don't really watch very many tarot YouTube. I kind of only watch if you're watching. I admit, I'm not very active in the tarot community.
Yeah, if I happen to have it on and you're in the room or something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I have to admit, I have to pick two because I can't pick between the two because I love them both. I'm very partial to Kasia of Tarot Map. She's wonderful.
Kasia is such a nice friend of our family now, isn't she?
Yeah, I've gotten
lovely
readings from her. I love her medicine wands, one of which I'm wearing.
You have a medicine wand.
Got this for Christmas. Mm-hmm. And then, she always has a lot of really interesting insights to different tarot-related things, so it's always fun when I can catch
her. Yeah, I like her style.
And then the other person who I love is Kelly Bear.
You do love Kelly Bear.
I love Kelly Bear. She is just, I mean, she is the exact person. I can't decide if I want to be or if I just want to be friends with her. Uh-huh. I mean, she is so much fun. She's just pure good
she's
fun.
She's so cool.
And she is so, so cool in all of her videos. I always feel like I learn so much and I get to see so much cool stuff whenever I watch her videos.
She's got such a fantastic personality as well. It really comes across.
Yeah, she's just so, like, quick and out there, and I love it. Yeah. Like, not, like, out there, like, weird out there, but I mean, like, when I say out there.
I don't think she'd object if you said weird out there.
But I mean out there, I mean, like, she tells it like it is, you know, and I like that. I really appreciate how, like, that's just the way she is, and I love that, so.
I guess if I had to pick one at the moment YouTube channel that I've been getting a lot out of, I would say it's Christine of Christine and Celeste, because, to be honest, she's been a bit like my tarot teacher the last few months. I've watched some of her videos over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. I mean, multiple times.
I think you watch her videos almost every single day.
Not weirdly. Not obsessively over and over again. Just multiple times. So that I can pick up what I missed the first time. So I'm not stalking her.
And even so, I think it would be okay if you were stalking her YouTube channel.
Yes. Stalking someone's YouTube channel is not too
weird.
That's
not creepy.
But I really feel like she's been teaching me a lot about reading intuitively, in particular, as I'm working through the course that I'm on. So I'm learning a lot of techniques, and I am learning about using my intuition. But I feel like I'm learning about using my intuition from a very different angle, from a more organic place, from Christine, where it's more something that you take the block down and let your intuition happen, as opposed to perhaps giving yourself opportunities to bring your intuition in. And that's more of a natural thing for me, because I have been very intuitive since I was a small child, mm-hmm. and it was something that I just couldn't use in my life.
Although it did sneak in a lot, because one of the things I can always remember is you knowing things that you couldn't have known. Like when I was growing up and stuff like that, just your intuition always coming out. We never had like a label to put on it about what it was, but it was always your intuition.
No, I always felt like I was just like I noticed things that other people didn't notice, and I saw things that other people didn't see because I paid more attention. For me, I mean, some of it was kind of survival mechanism. So I think my intuition went more into surviving in a toxic kind of. Anyway, moving on.
10. How many tarot decks do you have, Mom?
I counted 20 that I could see from the bed when I counted last night to make my notes. And I counted 10 oracles. And
I didn't count my oracles.
And that doesn't count the two packages. The two packages.
Sitting on the dining
room. It may have come in the mail this morning.
I think that's awesome. And I think
which may both be Oracle decks.
I think we're amateurs.
Are we amateurs?
Yes. I have 9 decks. I can't figure out if that's 9 tarot decks specifically. I didn't count oracles. I think I might have 6 oracles. And I don't know if I counted the one you gave me yesterday that I was edging. It's this really cute little tiny square party deck. I'll have to give that to you to show.
It's that little Barnes & Noble one.
Yeah,
I think it's really called Tarot. It's something that little like that. Tiny
it's really
Barnes
tiny. It's got
black. Like, everyone's seen it, I think.
Yeah, I edged it black and it looks fantastic.
Yeah,
it's excited nice. To it's use it. Deck. So I think I have 9 plus 6 Oracle decks.
We're totally amateurs.
Yes.
Yeah, complete amateurs. All right, 11. Is this the last question?
No, there are 15 questions.
Oh, okay. Do you mix oracles
and tarot when you read?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I like to. I like to match oracle and tarot
yes,
when I read.
Yes, that's the fun part.
I really like to match energetically, mm-hmm. either because they have the same vibration and they're kind of, they're vibing and they're working together, or because they each bring a different vibrational signature in. Mm-hmm. So perhaps one brings something more like that's an upper chakra vibrational signature that's a little bit higher, that's a little bit more woo-woo and spirit kind of oriented, which a lot of times that's tarot. So then I might try to bring a more grounded kind of oracle in. Mm-hmm. But then sometimes I'll do vice versa. If the tarot is a very woo-woo tarot, I might try to bring in a really...
If it's more grounded tarot.
Yes. If it's a more grounded tarot...
Bring in a more woo-woo oracle.
Yes. That's exactly
I do the same. I like mixing them, especially because I have the I Am Power deck. And I just use that basically with everything because it goes with everything and it's nice... to be able to draw an affirmation to go with the spread. But I also have other oracles, and I do enjoy just drawing an oracle clarifier. Like with my idiosyncratic deck, I also have the Cracked Amethyst Oracle by the same artist. And it's fun when you draw a tarot to draw a clarifying oracle to go with it. So. Yes, I do. 12. Have you ever created your own tarot card or deck?
No.
No. Which is weird for me. I'm surprised I haven't.
Did you bring your picture in that I said that could totally be...
That's upstairs.
Yeah, she drew...
We could insert it.
We could. What was the picture of?
I'd drawn it a couple years ago. It was of myself leaning over a puppet theater, and I had the puppet sticks in my hands, and I was controlling the puppets on the stage. I think there were 2 different puppets on like a park scene. One of them was sitting on the bench looking very grumpy, and the other one was sort of like jogging along beside them.
And I think you drew that because you write. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're an author because you've written a book.
Yes, technically.
That's on Amazon.
It is on Amazon.
Yeah, she's written a book. And
I'm working on my 3rd right now.
And you write a lot. So mm-hmm. I think that was kind of you feeling like the puppet master for your characters.
I constantly feel like that and like I make them suffer for no reason.
Yeah, but I looked at that image and I thought, oh, that's a great devil image.
Mm-hmm. I want to redraw it now.
Because it's one of those things where if you consider it, you think of there's a puppet master that looks like you. So usually when you look at the devil card, you would be, in that scene, you would be the marionettes. You would be the puppets being pulled about by the devil. What if you are the devil, mm-hmm. manipulating other people or even manipulating your own emotions?
Mm-hmm.
So,
I can insert a picture of that.
We could insert a picture. We'll try to do that. 13, do you read for yourself?
Yes.
All the time?
Yep. Every day.
And other people?
Every day.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I didn't count the Everyday Witch tarot. That's kind of both of ours.
It is all of ours.
Yeah.
It's kind of the family
it's
deck.
It's the family deck.
The family deck. I love that.
Yeah.
We keep it
in the dining room.
Okay. 14.
Favorite question to be asked when you read for someone else?
Did I write this down?
You want me to answer?
Yes, you go first because I don't think I wrote anything down. For this one. No, I did not.
Okay.
I have something.
Favorite question to be asked when you read? I really like it when somebody asks a good question. I think everybody says this all the time. That sometimes it's a little tedious to read for someone, like, should I get back with my ex or is he cheating on me? Am I going to get the job? Did I pass the test? And I understand that. In fact, I want to talk about that at some point. The
typical tarot questions.
Yeah, and where I think that comes from. But I like to be asked questions like, what do I need to do in order to make something happen, or what do I need to change, what do I need to start looking at in order to make something manifest in my life, or whatever. Mm-hmm. Those are kind of fun.
Yeah. I haven't really done many readings for people outside the family. Mm-hmm. And I didn't count my Lenormand decks either. Oh boy. So I don't really have a favorite question, but I know that whenever I get a tarot reading, I try very hard to ask specific questions that can get specific answers, because I know that with things that are spiritual or esoteric, that the more specific, if it's something where you ask a question, the more specific the question, the more specific the answer. And I also, I know that people appreciate, like when you get a reading, if someone has a very thoughtful question to ask. Mm-hmm. So I always try, so that's what I do. So I think if I gave more readings to other people, that's what I would appreciate as well, as when people, like you said, ask very thoughtful questions, especially mm-hmm. ones about personal growth. Because I think in tarot, sometimes people can tend to want to tell the future, not necessarily people reading tarot, but people who are asking for tarot readings mm-hmm. who might not be tarot readers themselves. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a lot of, like, there's a, that sort of future telling can, that fortune telling aspect of it is very tempting for a lot of people. So it is nice when people ask, instead of, am I going to get back with my ex? Something like, would it be, with it in my best interest to maintain a relationship with this person? If not, what can I do about that? Or, you know, something like, some kind of mm-hmm. more specific question. I do like the longer questions, because then it feels like people really thought about it, and like they thought to give backstory mm-hmm. about why they're asking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So good.
And what's the craziest thing that's happened to you during a reading? Has anything crazy happened to you during a reading?
Not anything like super weird. I mean, I've had, I think, the ones most people have, which is you get one card popping up 8 different times.
Right.
Because when you keep asking the same question, you keep getting the same
and
card.
And so you put it back in because you're like, no, that's not the answer. That wasn't really drawing yet.
Yeah, and then it keeps
And then
jumping
you draw
out.
Again, and then you get, like, the same cards.
Yeah.
And then you're I'm going to pick a different deck.
I've had this happen a lot.
And then you get
lot.
All the same cards.
I've had this happen a lot recently, and I'm trying to work with it a little bit. I think it's my intuition slipping in. When I guess I'm not as open to it, a lot of times when I'm shuffling, I'll be like, wouldn't it be weird if this card came up, and then that's the card I draw. Mm-hmm. So I think a lot of that is that, like, thought before the thought, mm-hmm. intuition. I just need to, like, work with it a little more instead of letting my brain jump in and go, oh, wouldn't it be funny if, you know, oh, that's so cute sort of thing. Mm-hmm. And being like, it's
the inner,
be
the inner critic.
Yeah.
Tends to talk over our intuition.
And then saying it's a coincidence that I just thought of it before mm-hmm. I drew it, and accepting the fact that sometimes I can know what card I'm going to draw before I draw it. Mm-hmm. And I can't make myself do that, unfortunately. I've tried. It only happens by accident.
Because you're listening.
Mm-hmm.
Or you're keyed in, or you're tuned in, or whatever metaphor you need. I always say listening, because that's how I process a lot of my intuition.
What about you?
Craziest thing that's happened to me during a reading? I can't really say crazy, and I kind of don't want to say, I want to be really cautious about, because I've done public readings for people. I did have one crazy question, which was a person told me that they knew their destiny was to invent the first time machine. And so they were curious, not about the invention of the time machine, but they were curious about what they might experience in their life, and how much their life would change after they had invented it. So that was a little bit interesting, and we kind of refined the question a little bit. But I did...
If they have a time machine, let me know. Maybe then I could go back and talk with Pixie Smith.
Yeah. And then another one that was a little bit of a bummer. I guess it's not crazy, but I did do a reading for someone who wanted a predictive reading. They specifically wanted to know about a specific type of situation over the next 3 to 6 months. And even though I explained that I don't do predictive readings, but that I would be I would be happy to do a reading where we looked at, say, what might this person experience over the next 3 to 6 months in a particular area if they made this choice, or what might they experience if they made that choice, and that was kind of where we went with it. And she gave me no stars because she didn't think it was likely to happen. So that's all right.
Maybe tarot isn't the right thing for her.
Yeah, well, that's okay. All right, that's the end of our question. And on a low note, hey, I could tell one funny story and we'll end on a high note. This is not the craziest tarot thing ever, but this is absolutely the craziest Reiki thing ever, and I've yet to top this, and I've had some pretty crazy things, but I did have someone seeking Reiki. I'm a Reiki practitioner and a Reiki teacher, as I've mentioned before, and I did have someone seeking Reiki specifically because they had an organ removed because of disease, and they wanted Reiki because they were interested in how many sessions it might take to grow it back. And I was quite honest with the person that I don't grow back organs.
Not for the price you charge?
Not for the price I charge.
And I think the FBI would be interested
in... The government would come and get me if I could grow back organs.
Area 51 for you, mother.
Can you imagine? I would be like, they would come and get me.
I'd have to come visit you in your glass prison.
No,
I said... As you grew people's organs back on the conveyor belt.
It'd be a terrible life.
That would be a terrible life.
It would be dystopia, so... I don't grow back
organs.
Yeah.
But maybe you can learn to live without it.
Maybe your body can balance and become its best self as you learn to accommodate the lack of the organ there. Or we work on the energetic organ. I'm sorry.
This is
not a Reiki class.
No, now I'm starting to think if you could do that, imagine if you had like a kidney removed and you sold it. Because apparently you can do that on the black market, and then you grew it back, and then you just kept doing that to pay off your student loans. Don't let me need your magical powers.
That's a short story. You can write that.
I should write that.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
If you decide to do this, please let me know. It's hashtag
tarot tag 15,
and it started with Arwen, and I believe Arwen is actually doing a giveaway, so if you make a video, make sure you use the tag, because I think she's doing some kind of a prize.
We can win something. Or we could just have fun. Okay.
Thanks for watching.
Thank you.
Bye.